with Hear Our Praises, all that's happening in our world this past week, stand with me as we open with Hear Our Praises. What a great song to open with this morning. Let's sing together. Sing it out from our hearts. Here we go.
Father, we thank you for a beautiful Sunday morning that you've given us. We thank you for the privilege that is ours to be able to come to your house today. Lord, we lift up our praise to you. You're worthy of all of our honor, glory, and praise. Lord, we just pray that you would make yourself known in our midst today. Holy Spirit, you come and you deal with each one of our hearts and lives. Just bless our time is our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated. I'm going to ask Brother Rex, as you were seated, I'm going to ask Brother Rex to come forward. He has a presentation to make, and I've turned this microphone on because he is going to speak unto it, and he's got a special presentation for us today. Brother Rex, you come up here and stand with me and talk unto us.
Brother Randall, today is Pastor Appreciation Day, and it is my
honor
to show our pastor our appreciation by a gift card for you and Pam, for you to use any way you would like. But I would like to tell you how much, as a congregation, that we love you for what you do for us each and every day of the year. Not just months.
Well, thank you, Brother Rex. There's not a church I'd rather be in than Carmel Baptist. And I know it's not enough just to say thank you, but I do appreciate each and every one of you. Thank you so much.
Amen. That is, amen. That feeling is mutual. We won't say what's in that card, but for a good while, you will not hear him or Pam have to say, "Where's the beef?" Do y'all remember those commercials? You know that lady's dead, right? Oh, that little, those Wendy's commercials, I think. Where's the beef? All right, that was, thank you, Brother Rex, so much. That was good. Hey, let's, I tell you what, you keep your seat, and I'm going to ask Brother Larry. Brother Larry Martin, would you do me a favor? Would you stand just a moment? Thank the Lord for Brother Mike, and just say a prayer over him and his family, he and Pam, this morning.
Heavenly Father, we thank you today for the many blessings that you've given us and brought us and continue to bring to us. We thank you for Brother Mike and Pam and their family. And as he leads us over the years and has ministered to us and been a pastor, Lord, there's a difference between pastoring and preaching, and he does both of them well. And we just thank you for giving him the guidance and the help and the attitude to do it right, Lord. And we just pray that you continue to be with them over the days and the years to come, and bless them as long as you will. We ask these things in your Son's name.
Amen. Thank you so much, Brother Larry. Thank you so much. I'm going to have to grab a tissue. Hang on just a second.
Okay. All right. We're going to sing another song. We're going to sing Days of Elijah. My week
is, the music that I select is, when I see what Brother Mike is preaching on and I read the passage, and I see what's happening in our world, and you're seeing what's happening in our world, correct? And so it's just driven by that, and so I just, I'm just thankful for a pastor, for a preacher that is so in tune to God's Word. All right, I'm going to have to stop talking because I won't be able to sing. Brother Mike, we love you. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Oh my goodness, if these screens go down, I'm in a... As the Indians would say, I'm a heap of trouble. Hymn number 289. This one's in the book. Most of it is anyway. Days of Elijah. Let's go, kids. I'm going to let you keep your seats.
Days of great trials, of famine and
like the sun. At trumpet calls, lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. There's no God like Jehovah. 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 Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At trumpet calls, lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At trumpet calls, so lift your voice.
Sang that song, lift your hand. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Very first time. Not my first time, lift your hand. Not my first time. I've sang that song before. Amen. Like a, not a Baptist church with all its hands lifted. I couldn't think of anything good to say. All right. Moving on, my wife said. Jesus is coming soon. So I told the kids in music run through, I've got to get a drink of water. Do y'all mind? Good, I'm glad you mind. I mind too. I felt like that we were rushing. Jesus is coming soon. I say this when we do this, and we do not do this song often, but does anyone think about a certain singing group when we sing Jesus is coming soon? Okay, Oak Ridge Boys, not who I was thinking of. The Gaithers, not, did you say Gaithers, Millie? Not who I was thinking of. Anybody else? Pardon? The women from here, what was that little group called? The Joy Singers. Who played that piano for them? Seiler. Louise Seiler played that. Does anybody remember the Joy Singers singing this? Thank you for that. I see that hand. Did you see that hand, brother? All right. That's who I think about. Went over like a lead balloon. Okay. I know it's not the same people. A lot of those, you know, it's like Mark Lowry when he said he watches those Gaither videos. What does he say when he sees all those people? Dead, 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 dead. I know a lot of us have gone on to the great reward. Jesus is coming soon. Not too fast. Let's go, guys. All right. I'll let you keep your seat. I know you need that warm spot. So, but sing with us. We're going to do it. Not too fast, Brandon Preston. They were pushing. Can you sing it? You just barely hear, aren't you? A little bit more, Brandon. Do it again. Here we go.
Morning or night or day.
going out there. Woo! It's a tough crowd. Okay? Anybody remember singing Thrive? Amen? You know, I remember this distinctly. And no, I'm not going to. But I remember when we decided to not sing it again, I remember distinctly Randa saying, "Good Dad," because we have done it 12 weeks in a row. But I know for a fact, because I shared this with a small group, we've not sung this song in 4 years, 4 months, 4 days, 4 hours, and 4 minutes. Okay? All right, there was a lot of fours, but really it has been 4 years, so. Y'all do need to stand. That was my wife. You didn't hear me say that. I was going to let you sit, but why sit when you can stand, okay? So it has been a while. Nelda wasn't even, she didn't even get to be here when we went through it. So, and I'm telling you, if the screens go down, yours truly is in a heap of trouble, all right? So, you ready, baby? Okay. Are y'all going to sing? Do you remember this Casting Crown song? Who was here when we did this before? Thrive. Four people. Okay, so it's going to be good. It's going to be good. Let's go. Track four, Brother Troy, because those other tracks are not going to work. We need number four. There's some O's in here, so get ready. It's the only words I'll get right. Tree planted by the water, we never will run dry. So living water flowing through, God, we thirst for more of you. Fill our hearts and flood our souls with one desire, just to know.
Anything is possible. Joy unspeakable, faith unsinkable, love unstoppable. Anything is possible. Joy unspeakable, faith unsinkable, love.
banjo. All right? You may be seated. I think you did much better that time than the very first time those years and years ago that we did this. It was a shock to your system. Does anybody remember how shocking it was the very first time you heard that? It was like I had gotten up here and fired a shotgun. It was unbelievable. So there was some special music that was supposed to take place.
Randall, we need to recognize our band that they won. And I know we have some kids here that are in the band.
Thank you, Sherry, so much. Kids in that room, could you stand up, please? Look at that. That is wonderful. Any of you play a banjo? We still love you. And we have one you can learn to play. I just heard that. It was either Linda or the Holy Spirit. I'm not sure. Their voices are so similar. Congratulations, guys. Amen. Children's Church. Yes. We do not want to forget that. So with everything that was going on this morning, is that the Andersons making their move?
Yes.
Oh, Graham's gone. Please, someone follow him. So I had a special that I had to back out on. I told Randa, I said, I'm sweating bullets here, baby. So Randa's going to play a little something, and then Brother Mike's going to come. And is this our last in Hosea? Amen. I sang that song, Thrive, because when I read those chapters, that if you've not read them all, I don't know how many of those verses Brother Mike's going to share this morning, but I thought of the song that we just did together when I read through these chapters in Hosea. I challenge you. And I got to tell you, when I think about who's going to go home and read these chapters, that number is very low. That's how much faith I have in you. I'm sorry. Yeah, I know. But I thought about it. Please prove me wrong, but pray for Randa as she plays and Mike as he comes to preach.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Randa. Beautiful, beautiful job.
Amen.
Well, if you have your Bibles, you turn with me to the Old Testament one more time, to the book of Hosea. Hosea chapter 11. And we'll begin reading this morning with verse 1. Hosea chapter 11, beginning with verse 1. And as we bring our study of this book to a close, I want to share a message with you entitled Our Future Glory. Hosea 11, 1. You stand with me now in reverence to God's word. God speaking through Hosea says, when Israel was a child, then I loved him and called my son out of Egypt. As they called him, so they went from them. They sacrificed them to Balaam and burned incense to graven images. I taught Ephraim also to go, taking them by their arms. But they knew not that I healed them. I drew them with cords of a man, with bands of love. And I was to them as they that take off the yoke on their jaws. And I laid meat unto them. He shall not return unto the land of Egypt, but the Assyrian shall be his king, because they refused to return. And the sword shall abide on his cities and consume his branches and devour them because of their own counsels. My people are bent to backsliding from me. Though they call unto them to the Most High, none at all would exalt him. How shall I give thee up, Ephraim? How shall I deliver thee, Israel? How shall I make thee as Admah? How shall I set thee as a bowl? My heart is turned within me. My repentings are kindled together. I will not execute the fierceness of my anger. I will not return to destroy Ephraim, for I am God, not man, the Holy One in the midst of thee. You may be seated. As always, I pray that the Lord would teach us. Father, we thank you, Lord, for a time of worship. We thank you, Lord, for this time that we can open your word and know that you will speak directly to our hearts. Lord, just bless our time in your word. It's my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. We bring our study of this book to a close. We're going to be looking at chapters 11 through 14. And the thing that I so love about them is that they don't end on a depressing note, which, quite frankly, is surprising because, as we have seen, the book of Hosea is a relatively depressing book, written against the background of his tragic marriage. God had called him to marry a woman who was a prostitute, and he did so, but then she left him to go after other lovers. A very apt picture of the relationship of the people of Israel to God. And in Hosea's messages that we've looked at over the past weeks, we've seen the results of their spiritual adultery. We talked about Israel's pollution. We talked about their punishment. But in these closing chapters, he talks about Israel's pardon. And so what we find ourselves looking at is a very uplifting message, a happy message. And again, as we look, we just need to keep in mind that he's writing from the background of his marriage, the story of how his wife, Gomer, returned to him and learned what it meant to be a faithful wife, the kind of wife she was supposed to be. And so what God is saying in these chapters to his people is, you, in spite of all that has happened to you, you need to understand there is future glory for you. And applying that to those of us who are his people today, God's saying the same thing. See, you know, there's future glory for us as well. Though we may fail the Lord at times, though we may wander away from him, when the final chapters of our Christian experience is written, it's going to be one of glory. And this is what I want us to look at in our time remaining. And as we look together at these verses, there are three things that I want to call your attention to. So what are they? Well, the first thing I want you to take note of is God's involvement with his people. His involvement with them. Beginning with chapter 11, God sort of takes us on a walk down memory lane as he talks to them about his past dealings with them. And, you know, if you go back to the book of Deuteronomy, you'll find God again and again telling his people, don't forget the ways that I've blessed you. Don't forget all the things that I have done for you. And beginning with verse 1 of our scripture, he reminds his people of that. He says, when Israel was a child, I loved him, and I called my son out of Egypt. And what he's talking about, of course, is what he did for them in the Exodus. The people of Israel were slaves to the Egyptians some 400 years. And yet God reached down and delivered them out of that bondage. And then he goes on in verse 3 and says, I taught Ephraim also to go. The word literally is to walk. I taught them to walk, taking them by their arms. And we know that this is a picture that he's painting for us of a father who's teaching a child how to walk. Do you remember when your kids were little and they were first trying to learn to walk and they would stumble and they would fall, and as a parent you would reach down and pick them up and hold on to their arms as they begin to take those first steps? Well, God wanted his people to know that's what he had done for them as well, and he wants the same for us. He wants us to remember his involvement in our lives. When we were first born into the family of God and began to our walk in the Christian faith, and though there were times that we stumbled, he was always there for us to hold us up and to keep us from falling. There has never been a time that God was not there for us. And you know, it's good from time to time just to stop and to look back and to remember his goodness and his patience with us. And then he says in verse 4, I drew them with cords of a man, with bands of love. See, he's reminding the people of Israel of his great love for them. And like the people of Israel, we need to be reminded of his great love for us. I mean, think, if you will, of when Jesus was hung there on the cross of Calvary. Have you ever wondered what it was that kept him there? What it was that kept him bound to that cross? It wasn't the nails in his hands and feet. That wasn't what kept him there. It was his love for us. You know, amazing grace, how can it be that thou, my King, would die for me? Unworthy though we were, Jesus endured death on the cross because of his love for us. And then in verses 5 and following, Hosea then takes over and he reminds God of how unworthy the people of Israel were. And in verse 8, God just interrupts in what has to be some of the greatest verses in this chapter. And he says, how shall I give thee up, Ephraim? How shall I deliver thee? Or as another translation puts it, how could I possibly let you go? Now, God said, I'm going to punish my people, but I'm not going to completely destroy them. I like what one writer I read said. He said, we see in this the dilemma of deity. You know, the Bible teaches that God is just, and therefore because he is, he has to deal with our sin. But it also teaches that God is love, and he wants to forgive us of those sins. And so the dilemma is, how can he be just and be love at the same time? And of course, we know how God solved that. You see, when Jesus went to the cross, God was just in that he poured out his punishment for our sins upon his own son. Yeah. And then he was loving in that in the death of Jesus on the cross, he offered forgiveness for our sins. And that, the writer said, is the wonder of the cross. And truly it is. Truly it is. God involved himself with his people. That's the first thing I wanted you to see. The second thing is not only God's involvement with his people, but his chastisement of his people. Turn over to chapter 12 and look at what he says in verse 2. The Lord hath also a controversy with Judah, and will punish Jacob according to his ways. According to his doings will he recompense. What he's talking about there is his chastisement. That word punish that he uses in that verse is really not a good translation. Because there's a difference between punishment and chastisement. Punishment is an expression of law. Chastisement, on the other hand, is an expression of love. It's like a father disciplining his child. And if you remember when you were kids, before spanking, your parents would say, "This is going to hurt me more than it does you." I don't know about anyone. I never bought that. I mean, they weren't the one getting the bell or the switch. But then, you know what? When you grow up and you become a parent, you understand that. I never got pleasure out of spanking our kids. But you see, if you love them, there are times when that becomes necessary. You know, Paige, I remember when Joe and Cindy were here. And I was preaching one Sunday morning on the family, a series on the family. I was preaching about parenting and how that if you truly loved your children, you were going to spank them. You were going to discipline them. And, you know, the boys were little at that time, and I don't remember what they had done. But when the service was over, I was standing at the back, and Cindy had a hold on both of them. And she was bringing them down the aisle, and when she passed, she looked up and said, "I'm going to take these boys home, and I'm going to really love them." Well, you know, there are times when God has to really love on us. There are times that he has to do that in order to bring us back to where we need to be. Look again at what he says. Verse 2, the Lord hath a controversy with Judah, and it says, will punish Jacob according to his ways. Now, if you go back to the book of Genesis, chapter 25, you'll read about the birth of Jacob and Esau. Now, Esau was the firstborn. But the Bible says that when Jacob came out, he grabbed hold of his brother Esau's heel, and therefore his name was called Jacob. Grabber. Or a trickster, or schemer, which was exactly what he was, because he was always trying to get by trickery and deception. And the thing is that by birth, we're all like that. And so when God saves us, there are certain things in our hearts and in our lives that are there because of that old fallen nature. You know, when you get saved, God doesn't do away with that fallen nature. He don't have it till you die. He gives you a new nature, but that old nature is there also. And so, because that's true, God sometimes has to do a work of chastisement in our lives to loosen our hold on that old life and to increase our grasp on that new life. And he does it in order to bring us to where we need to be. And that's the way it is so many times with those of us who are parents. You know, there are times when we deal with our children and also our grandchildren when all we can pray is, "God, you do whatever it takes to bring this child back to you." And sometimes that's not an easy thing to do. But we do it. Why? Because we love them. And that's what God did with his people Israel. Now, turn over to chapter 13. And I want you to look at what he says about his people in verse 2. Now, they sin more and more, and have made them molten images of their silver and idols according to their own understanding. All of it the work of the craftsmen. They say of them, "Let the men that sacrifice kiss the calves." He's talking about their idolatry. And look at verse 11. "Therefore," he says, because of their idolatry. I will be unto them as a lion, as a leopard by the way will I observe them. I will meet them as a bear that is bereaved of her whelp, and will rend the call of their heart, and there will I devour them like a lion. Wild beast shall tear them. God says, though it breaks my heart to do it, if that's what it takes to bring them back to me, then that is what I'm going to do. You know, I tell you, I fear for those who think that they can just wander away from God and there not be any consequences. You know, that's what they think. They're in for a rude awakening. Because God will do whatever necessary, even if it means taking away everything that they have, He'll do it in order to bring them back. Well, that's the second thing I wanted you to see. And then the third and last thing I want you to take note of is not only God's involvement with His people and His chastisement of them, but also His commitment to His people. His commitment to them. Now, look at chapter 14. And notice what he says in verse 1. He says, O Israel, return unto the Lord thy God, for thou hast fallen by thy iniquity. God is saying, come back to me. Come back to me. Verse 4. I want you to notice what he says there. Well, in verse 2, he says, take with you words and return to the Lord. Now, this is so important. If you're going to come back to the Lord, what are you going to say to Him? What are you going to tell Him? You say, well, I'm not going to tell Him anything. I'm just going to come back. It doesn't work that way. God says, you want to come back to me, then you had better bring words with you. Remember when the prodigal son finally came to his senses in the hog pen? What did he say? He said, I will arise and go to my father. Is that all that he said? No. He said, I will say, Father, I've sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. See, you want to come back to God. There's only one way that you can do it, and that is by admitting that you have sinned and asking for forgiveness. But watch what happens when you do that. Verse 4, God says, I will heal their backsliding. I will love them freely, for my anger is turned away from them. I'll be as the dew unto Israel. He shall grow as the lily, cast forth his roots as the Lebanon. His branches shall be spread. His beauty shall be as the olive tree. His smell as Lebanon. What he's saying is that those who genuinely repent of their sins and seek forgiveness, God says, I will richly pour out my blessings upon them. And notice how he closes in verse 9. He says, who's wise and understand these things? Prudent and shall know them. The ways of the Lord are right, and the just shall walk in them. But the transgressors shall fall therein. He's saying that there are two paths to life. There are two roads to travel. The road of right living and the road of wrong living. And he says, choose the right road and come to me. Don't choose the wrong road and walk away. Because one leads to blessing, the other to cursing. And in the end, one leads to heaven and the other leads to hell. And so he says, choose the right road and come to me. That's the way of future glory. Now, I'm gonna tell you something. I don't know if you understand how desperate a time we're living in today. Just this morning, on the news, Iran has threatened Israel that if they make a ground incursion into the Gaza Strip, there will be terrible consequences. And if Iran gets involved, that we two warships out in the Mediterranean, Russia and China are both with Iran. We're as close to another world war as we have ever been in our lives.
It's true.
The Lord is coming soon.
He is.
And people had better wake up and understand before it's too late. You see, what he's saying to some today is you had better come now. There are those here this morning, maybe some young people who've never placed their faith in Jesus Christ. I'm going to tell you, if you don't come before it's too late, you're not going to come at all. And there are those who know that they're saved, and yet you've wandered away from God. You better come back yourself. The time's now. If you're going to make a decision, you need to come. That's what he's saying. You come. Receive your future glory. You bow with me. Father, we thank you. Lord, for your precious word. Lord, we thank you for all that you have done for us. But Lord, we just ask that you would bless those who need to make decisions today. That they would come before it's too late. Lord, as we come to this time of invitation, we just give it to you. And Holy Spirit, we ask that you would bless it. Lord, we pray that you would speak to hearts today. Whether young or old, Lord, if there are decisions that need to be made, let them come today. Lord, we give it to you in Jesus' name. Amen. You stand with me as we sing our hymn of invitation this morning. If you know that the Lord is speaking to your heart, if you know that the Holy Spirit is speaking to you and telling you that you need to make a decision, don't put it off. You come as we sing.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus.
Anyone, will you come?